The next item of business is an urgent question on the COVID-19 vaccine delivery from Donald Cameron. Now, before calling Mr Cameron, I want to comment on the remarks made at the Scottish Government's briefing today in relation to the authorisation of a COVID-19 vaccine. The news of that authorisation is a very welcome and significant matter, but I want to reiterate to all members that my expectation is that such significant matters and announcements should be made to the Parliament and the Chamber in the first instance. Now I call, it's not a matter for applause, I call Donald Cameron to ask his urgent question.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the rollout of COVID-19 vaccines following the approval of the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Answering the question, I think it would be helpful for me to just outline the timeline in terms of events this morning. So, as we know, news this is the news that we have been hoping for since March. So it is really, as you say, really, really good news and really important. Last night there was a Four Nations meeting between Scottish ministers
on,
and Mr Hancock.
Mr Fitzpatrick. Mr Fitzpatrick, before you go on, you're here to answer a question from Mr Cameron, urgent questions. I hope it's not a remark on my comments from the chair. Just answer the question from Mr Cameron, please.
I think my point was to lay out when the announcement was actually made rather than the suggestion that's been made.
It sounds to me, Mr Fitzpatrick, that you're questioning my ruling. I would rather you answered the question from Mr Cameron. Thank you.
Okay, I'll try and include some of those contexts. So following the announcement by the Medicines and Healthcare Production Regulatory Agency this morning, the publication of the final recommendations for the Joint Committee of Vaccination and Immunisation also met this morning, and the Four Nations ministerial call, which also was met this morning at 6:30 after a call from Matt Hancock last night. That was then, I think, followed up by an announcement to the Stock Exchange at 7 a.m. And at that meeting at 6:30, the Four Nations and members will all be aware that we have agreed we'll always take a Four Nations approach, that the Four Ministers agreed at that call that vaccination of the COVID-19 Pfizer vaccine will start in Scotland on Tuesday, the 8th of December, as proposed with business managers this morning and subject to the Parliament's agreement at decision
time. Please stop. Sit down, please. Mr Fitzpatrick, you're here to answer an urgent question from members, not to address comments from the Chair or any other matter. Now, if you please address the question that Mr Cameron asked you and not address your question to or your remarks to my remarks.
I'm trying very hard to. So following all the things that happened this morning, the vaccinations, as I said, of the COVID-19 Pfizer vaccine will start in Scotland on Tuesday, the 8th of December. As I understand, business managers this morning, and obviously subject to Parliament's agreement at decision time, the Cabinet Secretary will provide Parliament with further details on this statement, on this in a statement tomorrow.
Thank you. Mr Cameron.
Thank you for that answer. This is a truly breakthrough moment and offers hope of a return to normality at the end of what has been a long and difficult year. However, it's deeply disappointing that the Scottish Government refused a request for the First Minister to give an urgent statement to Parliament today, given the significance of this news. In the absence of such a statement, will the Minister now agree to publish today the full vaccine delivery plan reviewed at Cabinet yesterday? And if not, when will we see it?
Minister.
So I think I've tried to outline the timelines. I think, as I understand, the SNP's, the Scottish Government's business manager, spoke to other business managers this morning and offered a statement tomorrow, which I hope will be agreed by Parliament, and that will be the point where all of the detail will be able to be discussed. There is a team of people continuing to work on the detail, making sure that the vaccine is rolled out in Scotland on Tuesday, the 8th of December, in a safe and an appropriate way. The work is continuing on that detail. An extensive piece of publications came out from the MHRA this morning, and also extensive documentations from the Joint Committee for Vaccination and Immunisation also this morning, which is why all that detail is being looked at to make sure that the Cabinet Secretary can give as detailed a statement and response to questions tomorrow, as hopefully this Parliament will agree.
Donald Cameron.
I understand there are still uncertainties, but vulnerable people and their families need answers as soon as possible. People across Scotland are desperate to know who will be able to access the COVID vaccine first, particularly those with relatives in care homes where more than 2,000 Scottish people have tragically lost their lives. Can the Minister confirm today that Scotland will implement the recommendations of the JCVI, which prioritise care home residents and staff?
Minister.
The recommendations of the JCVI is one of the things that was being discussed this morning at 6:30, and of course the Scottish Government, like the other nations of these islands, will be following the advice of the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation. That is so important. In terms of, if you look at the paper that was published this morning, and I accept it's a pretty extensive document, so there's a lot of detail in there. When we vaccinate all of the groups that JCVI recommend, that will, they believe, protect 99% of the people most likely to die. It's a really significant piece of work, and it's really important that across all four nations that we follow the advice of the JCVI. And I want to just say to Mr Cameron, this is absolutely a piece of work that has been taken forward, or a project that's been taken forward on a four-nation basis in a very, very collaborative way. And Mr Hancock, Cabinet Secretary, and the Health Secretaries from Wales and Northern Ireland have all been working very closely and very collaboratively to make sure that we can deliver the vaccine as quickly and as safely as all the advice and the supply allows.
Thank you. Emma Harper, to be followed by Monica Lennon.
The Scottish Government has previously set out that 23 ultra-low temperature freezers have been purchased to store the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine. In tomorrow's statement, can the Minister advise if this approach will help ensure that access to the vaccine is possible, regardless of where you live?
Minister.
Obviously, the Cabinet Secretary tomorrow will give more detail, but the Member is absolutely right. The characteristics of this vaccine have particular challenges, the challenges in relation to transportation, challenges in relation to ultra-low storage, and that was some of the advice which was just published this morning by MHRA. Some of the detail that has to be looked at really carefully is about that transportation. But we have ensured that there are 23 ultra-low temperature freezers located throughout Scotland, including three in the Highlands, to account for geography. But we are awaiting, again, final clarification from MHRA on the extent to which we can pack down and transport the vaccine once it's defrosted, as clearly there are some communities that will be unable to travel to the vaccination centres. So board plans are looking to take all that into account in its complexity. Just to explain the challenge in terms of the packing down, the vaccine will be supplied to the four nations in packs of 997 doses, each of which then have to be diluted into batches of five used to vaccinate the population. So we need to get the piece of the puzzle that we still have to get final answers from MHRA on is whether that 997 doses can be packed down into smaller packages. And that's something that's particularly relevant to all nations, but I think most important, particularly for our rural areas, particularly if we can't transport the vaccine once it's been unpacked.
Thank you. Monica Lennon, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a victory for science, and we applaud everyone involved in the vaccine development, including the volunteers who made the trials possible. It's fantastic news that people in Scotland will start to get the vaccine in just 6 days' time, so the details absolutely matter, because we need to get this right and hit the ground running. Almost 2 weeks ago, I asked the Cabinet Secretary a number of questions. She promised to write back to me, Presiding Officer. I don't yet have the answers. I'm not sure who's in charge of the vaccine programme. Perhaps the Minister will advise. But can he tell us tonight, of the 2,000 vaccinators and support staff that the Cabinet Secretary will be required by the end of January, what proportion of them will be vaccinators? We still don't know. And can he say, given that GPs will play Given that GPs will play a crucial role, and I asked the Cabinet Secretary what support will be in place to make sure that they can still see patients on a timely basis, what additional support is in place for primary care to ensure that people can see their GPs on a timely basis? And lastly, how many NHS and social care staff does he expect will have
that's both doses questions.
By the end of January? Thank you.
Joe Fitzpatrick, Minister.
I think the last piece was the proportion of health and social care staff. Is that... Yeah, so...
Order, sorry, please, sorry, Minister.
That's a really, really important point, actually, about the health and social care staff. If you look at the advice of the JCVI as it stands, there are two/three groups who are in the absolute priority for the first wave, and that is the health and social care staff, frontline health and social care staff, direct patient-facing, those in care homes, elderly care homes, and those over 80. And we're still reliant on the supply of vaccine, but assuming that comes in something like what we expect, then we would be certainly hoping that that first wave of the most vulnerable group would be vaccinated by February, so by the end of February, certainly. There's a part of that we still don't have absolute clarity on the supply chain of the vaccine coming in, and that's a challenge for it. But within the advice from the JCVI, the groups that the member's talking about are an absolute priority. So it's really important that we get them. And I appreciate the tone of the member's question, because it is really important. We have a very important role, I think, to encourage particularly that group, but other vulnerable groups as well, to come forward and get the vaccine. The evidence from the vaccine is really good in terms of its ability to protect individuals, so to protect those most vulnerable people. We still don't know whether it gives that herd immunity to protect other people, which might make us make different choices in the future, but right now we know it is very good. All the advice is very good at protecting that vulnerable group. So,
thank you. And Willie Rennie.
This is certainly a good day, but it does show what the government thinks of this Parliament, that it sends the Minister to deliver this wholly unconvincing and inadequate explanation this afternoon. But does the Minister know this? Why are those who were on the shielding list not prioritised for the vaccine?
Sir.
Those on the shielding list are prioritised in the vaccine. They're just not in that very first wave, because they're not in the very first wave. They absolutely are on the first group. I encourage the member to look at the JCVI advice, but it kind of goes through a range of individuals. Obviously, as I said, the first wave starting at the with those over 80, those in care homes, health and care workers. And it then goes down the age groups, with the exception of that very vulnerable group of 16 to 64-year-old being included in that phase. I think that might have been a very late addition, but it's certainly from 16 to 64-year-old vulnerable who have been definitely within the priority groups. And that's really important, because doing that group, including those people and everyone above 50, accounts for, according to the JCVI, 99% of the likely death. So it's really important that we do follow the advice of the JCVI. On the member's point about respect for this Parliament, I go back to the point that the announcement was made by MHRA this morning. We've always had a four nations approach, and Matt Hancock made several announcements about the date on the television this morning. There was also a briefing from the JCVI at 10 a.m. this morning. So the suggestion that we've announced this in some other way is just bizarre. And I hope members will appreciate the huge amount of work that is going into making sure that the programme in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK is effective and safe. It's a massive collaborative effort across the four nations. And I think all the folk involved in bringing together that programme to make sure that the vaccination can start next Tuesday should be congratulated by us all.
Thank you. And we'll move on from the urgent question. The next item is consideration of business motion 23573 in the name of Graeme Day on behalf of the Bureau setting out a revision to tomorrow's business. Could I call on the Minister to move this motion? Thank you. No member has indicated they wish to speak in the motion. The question, therefore, is that motion 23573 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The next item is consideration of business motion 23551, also in the name of Graeme Day on behalf of the Bureau setting out a business programme. No member has indicated they wish to speak. Could I call on the Minister to move this motion?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that motion 23551 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The next item is consideration of business motions 23552 and 23553 on stage one timetable for two bills and 23554 on a stage two timetable for a bill. Could I call on Graeme Day to move these motions?
Moved.
That is moved. No member has indicated they wish to speak. The question, therefore, is that motions 23552, 23553 and 23554 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Now, the next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 23563 on approval of an SSI, and this is the postponement of revaluation order. I believe Liam Kerr wishes to speak against this motion. Mr. Kerr. Oh, sorry, I beg pardon. Could I call the Minister, first of all, to move the motion? I beg pardon. I call on Kate Forbes, in this case, to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you. And could I call on Liam Kerr? Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Presiding Officer. I rise to speak against the order and urge MSPs to vote against it at decision time tonight. This order concerns the business rates that our shops, enterprises, hospitality, restaurants and so on pay each month. Periodically, there's an assessment of how much rates each should pay, and this order seeks to move the date on which the next assessment will be made. If this order is passed today, instead of business rates being reassessed and a different figure coming from April 2022, the reassessment will be pushed back, with the rates changing from April 2023. Now, may I just make a little progress, Ms. Boyack? I'll come back to you. Now, I understand why that's being proposed. The Minister will tell us his concern is that if we reassess the figures any earlier, the result won't be truly reflective of conditions in the market due to the coronavirus pandemic. I expect he'll tell us that pushing the re-evaluation back will allow current and post-COVID trading to be assessed. It will allow time for the vaccine to do its thing, the people to get back on the high street and sales to stabilise. I get that. But, Presiding Officer, it doesn't work when set against the principles that the Minister will claim to be working to. It doesn't work because the whole point of the Barclay Review of Rates was to design a rate system that directly responds to changing market conditions. Presiding Officer, these are the changing market conditions. So any delay to the revaluation as per this order runs counter to the flagship recommendation for more, not less, frequent assessments. And furthermore, members will be aware that the Scottish Government recently brought in legislation to further constrain appeals under material change in circumstances grounds, which only really works in a context in which there are more regular revaluations. If this order goes through today, pushing the next reassessment back, having removed this crucial ground of appeal, it will be the perfect storm for many businesses. In other words, this order brings in a one-size-fits-all solution which doesn't fit all, and certainly doesn't fit for the North East. I'll take an intervention, Sarah Boyack.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the member for taking an intervention? Would Mr Kerr agree that although the majority of Scottish businesses do support a delay in the tone date, the evidence we took at the committee showed that many business groups do not support the tone date we have in front of us tonight. And it's disappointing that the SNP government were not prepared to bring forward the alternative tone date, which many would prefer, especially in the light of and the lack of a robust economic assessment that would enable us to take a good decision.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you. I thank the member for the intervention. Yes, I do agree with that. I can see from the record that many business groups didn't support what's proposed tonight, and I'll be speaking specifically of one shortly and a solution that I think might be of interest. Presiding Officer, the last revaluation was several years ago. The North East was accordingly assessed against trading conditions as they stood at that time. It was a reassessment that completely failed to take into account the impact of the oil downturn and its effect on the northeast economy. As a result, business rates bills were based on rateable values that failed to reflect the reality of trading in the northeast when they came into force in 2017. Northeast businesses have been paying eye-watering rates ever since. This is their chance, at last, to be reassessed against realistic trading conditions, to be assessed against the market as it is in the northeast, not as the central belt thinks it is. Businesses in the North East cannot wait any longer. You just need to walk down Aberdeen's Union Street to see the impact of the crippling and inaccurate rates on this great city. Presiding Officer, MSPs need not feel pressured into voting for this order today. There is a solution, and it is in the Scottish Government's own paper as an option two. That solution is one that's endorsed by Aberdeen and Grampian Chamber of Commerce, and that I suspect Sarah Boyack was referring to earlier, that the government carry on with the 2022 revaluation, but introduce a valuation date of the 1st of April 2021. Revaluing rates as early as possible to align rateable values with current market conditions in light of COVID-19 and the most recent restrictions would be a fairer and vastly more sensible step to aid economic recovery than delaying the revaluation. Presiding Officer, for years, the conditions against which the North East was assessed have not existed. For years, the North East has been paying crippling business rates that have had dramatic, sometimes terminal impacts on our high streets and jobs. It must not continue for 1 minute longer than necessary. The solution is clear. MSPs should vote against this order, send this back to committee to reconsider option two, and deliver a fair deal for the North East. At decision time tonight, MSPs can back the North East and its people by doing so.
And Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Contrary to Liam Kerr's point, the Barclay Review's primary concern was to provide stability and minimise the impact of economic shocks. It would be irresponsible for the Scottish Government to proceed with a 2022 revaluation based on information as at April 2020, just a month into lockdown. This is not a political decision tonight, which is clearly demonstrated by the fact that the Scottish, the Welsh and the UK governments have all taken the same decision. This delay was also requested by Ruth Davidson in the chamber on the 1st of September, the day the proposal to do exactly that was announced at the Programme for Government. So I see the Conservatives now want to do a U-turn on Ruth Davidson's request. Yes, I will. If I've got time. Do I have time?
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much. Would the Cabinet Secretary acknowledge that the tune date is actually different in Scotland to Wales and the rest of the United Kingdom?
Cabinet Secretary.
And it's something that I would celebrate because it minimises the time for the market to be considerably different at the point at which the revaluations are based. And actually, a one-year tone date, which was recommended by the Barclay Review, was precisely to minimise the shocks, and therefore it's something that we should be proud of being able to deliver in this country. Now, the equivalent delay in England was described by the UK local government minister, who I believe is a Conservative, Luke Hall, as important, I quote, and common sense, whilst Labour MP Kate Holleran similarly said it was, and I quote, a common sense response to the virus. The Chamber should know that there is no political or financial benefit from the delay. On the contrary, annulling these regulations ensures that the system reverts to a 2022 revaluation with a tone date of the 1st of April 2020, increasing uncertainty for business, locking them into new revaluations that likely don't reflect the full impact of the pandemic, and risking the government's ability to fund a programme of business support because of the risk to public finances. Now, Liam Kerr said that we should reflect market conditions. Information as at 1st of April 2020 would not reflect market conditions. And the big fear and concern, based on the evidence that we have received, is that information as at April 2021 would not reflect market conditions either. As Sarah Boyack rightly said, the business community agreed universally that the status quo is not an option. And annulling this regulation will force us back to the status quo. Scottish businesses also agree overwhelmingly that their number one priority is certainty over the future of reliefs, and that is quite a different discussion in advance of next year's budget than locking businesses into revaluation values. The Chancellor systematically failed to provide the devolved administrations with any clarity over the future of non-domestic rates reliefs in a statement last week, and instead of posturing this afternoon over the date of the revaluation, I think we should be uniting to call on the Chancellor to provide certainty now rather than waiting until March, which is only a month before the beginning of next financial year. These regulations are based on an understanding of the risks to businesses, which is in turn based on the most robust and verifiable evidence and data that we have. It is the same, and I quote, common sense approach adopted in Wales and England under the Labour Party and the Conservative Party. And I call on Parliament not to agree to the proposal to annul, not for the sake of government, but for the sake of businesses in every constituency who've been through the most challenging of years.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. The decision, the vote on that matter will be taken at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 23557 on approval of an SSI. This is the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment. Can I call on Graeme Day to move and to speak to this amendment?
In keeping with the COVID scrutiny protocol that was agreed between the Government and Parliament, I should outline the purpose of this SSI, which is to modify some of the restrictions and requirements for the different levels and set out changes to the level that applies to some areas of Scotland. The regulations give effect to the First Minister's announcement of 10th November and came into force on 13th November, and I move the motion.
Mr. Allen's indicated he wished to speak on this, or is that just a... No.
That's...
Thank you. So moving on to the decision on this, SSI will be taken at decision time too. The next item is consideration of six Parliamentary Bureau motions. Could I call on Graeme Day on behalf of the Bureau to move motions 23561, 23568, 23560, 23562 on approval of SSIs?
Moved.
23555 on acting conveners and 23556 on committee membership.
Moved.
Thank you. Now we're going to turn to decision time. The first question this evening is that Amendment 23537.2 in the name of Fiona Hislop, which seeks to amend motion 23537 in the name of Alec Rowley on BIFAB, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We're going to move to a vote, but we're just going to suspend briefly to allow members to access the voting app. So a short suspension to allow members to access the app. Thank you, colleagues. We are now back in session. We're going to go straight to the vote. So the question is that Amendment 23537.2 in the name of Fiona Hislop, which seeks to amend Motion 23537 in the name of Alec Rowley on BIFAB, be agreed. And members may cast their votes now. This will be a 1 minute division. Point of order from Alistair Allen.
Point of order, I had an error message that suggests that my vote wasn't counted.
Thank you, Mr. Allen.
Thank you.
I can assure Mr. Allen his vote was counted. Thank you, colleagues. The result of the vote on amendment number 25537.2 in the name of Fiona Hislop is yes 60, no 61. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 23537.1 in the name of Liz Smith, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Alec Rowley, be agreed. Are we agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote. Members may cast their votes now. That vote is now closed. Point of order, Kevin Stewart.
I've got the weirdest screen ever in my phone, so I think that my vote may not have been counted. I would have abstained.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Your vote was counted, Mr. Stewart. Point of order, Liz Smith. Yes. Thank you, Ms. Smith. I just add your vote to the voting roll. Ms. Smith would have voted yes. Could I call Angela Constance to make a point of order?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sorry to say that the app on my phone wouldn't allow me to vote. And if I was able to vote, I would have abstained. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Constance. I will make sure that your vote is added to the voting register. Thank you. Thank you. The result of the vote on amendment number 23537.1 in the name of Liz Smith is yes 61, no 2. There were 58 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 23537 in the name of Alec Rowley as amended on BIFAB be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote. Members, we cast their votes now. This is a 1 minute division. That vote is now closed. The result of the vote on motion 23537 in the name of Alec Rowley as amended is yes 61, no 60. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. On the fourth question, I would remind members that if the amendment in the name of Kate Forbes is agreed, then the amendment in the name of Maurice Golden will fall. So the question is that amendment 23536.2 in the name of Kate Forbes, which seeks to amend motion 23536 in the name of Richard Leonard on business support, be agreed. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a division. Members may cast their votes now. And again, a 1 minute division. That vote is closed. The result of the vote on amendment number 23536.2 in the name of Kate Forbes is yes 65, no 56. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. That means that the amendment in the name of Maurice Golden is preempted. And so we go to the question. The motion 23536 in the name of Richard Leonard as amended be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Sorry, okay, we're not agreed. We'll move to a division. This is a division on the amended motion in the name of Richard Leonard. It will be a 1 minute vote. That vote is closed. The result of the vote on motion 23536 in the name of Richard Leonard as amended is yes 96, no 23. There was one abstention. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 23563 in the name of Graham Day on the postponement of re-evaluation coronavirus Scotland order be agreed. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. We'll move to a division and members may cast their votes now. This is on motion 23563, approval of an SSI. On 1 minute division. That vote is now closed. The result of the vote on motion 23563 in the name of Graham Day is yes 65, no 34. There were 22 abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 23557 in the name of Graham Day on approval of the Health Protection Restrictions and Requirements Amendment be agreed. Are we agreed? Yes. We are agreed. And I propose to ask a single question on six Parliamentary Bureau motions. Does any member object? The question is that motions 23561, 23558, 23560, 23562, 23555 and 23556 in the name of Graham Day on behalf of the Bureau be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, and that concludes decision time. We're going to move shortly to members' business in the name of Stuart Stevenson on recognising the importance of whole grains on International Whole Grain Day. There'll just be a short pause while members change seats. I would just encourage all members to wear their masks, to observe social distancing and one-way systems around the building when leaving the chamber. Thank you.